stopping by the studio. It's been a few weeks since I've made a video, but I haven't been coasting. I've been busy on today's painting, and I think you're in for a treat. Before we go over and talk about what we did and what I'm going to show and what I'm not going to show, if you're itching just to get to the painting part, I'll put a timestamp down in the description so that you can go ahead and jump ahead. But it might be worth sticking around for a few minutes and hearing the explanation. So come on, join me over at the easel. All right, well, here we are at the easel. This is the painting that I worked on for the last 3 or 4 weeks. It's obviously it's a stage robbery scene, and I've decided to call it Making an Early Withdrawal. Now, a painting that's as complicated as this does take some time to do, and I wouldn't be able to show you the whole thing even at super high speed in an hour. I kept a track of my hours this time, and I found that it took me, in 3 weeks, it took 120 hours, so that's basically 3 40-hour work weeks. And what I did decide to show you on this are kind of the strategic parts of the painting. And so we start with a completely blank canvas, and I paint in a lot of the things around it, but then I go ahead and show you painting the figures, the main figures, this gentleman, these two guys, I think some of the stagecoach, and the two draft horses. And what I also did was I took a photo every day before I started on the painting, so that you saw the progression of the painting from the very start to the very end. Towards the end of the video, I'll go ahead and put it into a kind of a time lapse so that you'll be able to see just what I did, when I did it, and all the way up through until it was framed. But yeah, and oh, also, I think what I'd like to do is regularly, I kind of do this on my videos now, I'll show you the reference that I used and kind of pulled all together. I think there were probably some 15 photos that I used for this. I don't think there were quite 20, but I changed everything around so that it worked as a painting rather than just use exactly the reference that I had. So I think you'll be interested to see that. If you're looking to start doing some more complicated work, or to do some story paintings, and you know, how do you take different reference and kind of meld it all together, we can talk a little bit about that as we go along. But let's go ahead and get into it. So the first photo is my stagecoach base photo. I just used the coach for this. Didn't like the figures or the horses or the background. And so I used this photo for the background. And I knew that I was going to be changing it around. But here is the stagecoach horses that I used. The other ones just weren't quite right. This is the far right horse. Here's the horse and rider on the right-hand side. I didn't have very good reference. I didn't like where his gun hand was pointing. So I had that reshot, and this is the gun arm that I used. I can put it wherever I wanted on him. And this is the driver and the shotgun rider. I liked their poses, so these are the shots that I used. And of course, I needed some reference for what the strong box would have looked like back then. And so I went on the internet and I found this. So it's not exactly this, but at least this gives me an idea as to what it's supposed to look like. And here's the reference for the period appropriate guns that were thrown on the ground. Some extra shotgun reference. Here's some new reference that I shot for the standing robber, because the reference that I took at the time just wasn't good enough. Here's some money bags that were at his feet, and the mounted rider on the left-hand side. It was a little blurry, so I needed to reshoot his gun arm. And of course, I needed some fallen tree reference that I could put in the middle of the road that would have stopped the stagecoach. Didn't follow it exactly, but it gave me an idea as to what it was supposed to look like. And here's the sketch all pulled together using all the different reference. And from here, I went and I had a transfer print done to the size that I needed it and transferred it down onto my canvas. there it is on the canvas, all sealed, toned, ready to go. So as you can see, this is a bit of a process, but the more time that you put in on the front end, the easier time you're going to have once you get sitting in front of your easel or standing in front of your easel with your paintbrush in your hand. The more problems I work out early, the less I have to contend with later. You're already juggling enough balls as it is trying to get a decent painting. So I work out all the drawing problems and composition problems before I ever pick up a brush. So what do you say? Let's get on to painting. The thing that I decided to do on this one was to go ahead and do the background, all of the surrounding layers first. And so the first thing I did was the sky, the mountain, and the trees on the right-hand side. That helped to establish what my background values were going to be, and I could knock them back far enough to not have to worry about them later. Second step, I continued on around the right-hand side, painted in the ground, the cowboy, and his horse. Now this took a couple of days, but it gives you an idea. I'm painting kind of in a clockwise fashion, and I'm not painting anything that's isolated from anything else. It's all connecting, so I can relate those values to the values I've already painted. Does that make sense? So here I am. I continue around by putting in the road, the rest of the rider, and the left-hand side of the ground and the grass. The guns took a little bit of time that were laying on the ground, but you know, those are a pretty important part of the painting, so you want to make sure they're right off the bat. And I noticed that I only have 2 out of the 3 guns in at the moment, but the other one will come in soon. Next, I put in the left-hand side background and the strong box that the shotgun rider's holding. And so now we get to the painting part, kind of the meat and potatoes of the painting with the driver and the shotgun rider. This is where I will show you how I painted it and what I was thinking when I was doing it, but I needed to show you what I did up until this point. So let's get started on the shotgun rider. And I've decided to start on his hat because it's a good dark value that I can judge everything else against. And it's not the face, so it's a little bit simpler to get going on. But you have to be accurate on this because everything else on his face is going to be judged against the value that I've got going in his hat, if that makes sense. So I'm starting by putting in 2 different values. I'm going to put in the shadow side, and I'm going to put in the side that's in light, and then spend most of my time blending the two. Now, the style of his hat is known as a Montana peak, which was pretty popular with these guys back in the day. It basically is as if you would take a cowboy hat and pull on the very top. You've got 4 different sides, and it was an easy hat to put on and take off, and I like the color pretty well, but you know, just I'm not too worried about the edges right now. I'm just worried about getting the values correct. So there's the light side, and then obviously on the back part of the hat and the underneath of the brim is the shadow side. And so you get the darks in there and you get the lights in, and then you just blend the two. After you get done with that, and it's time to play around with the edges. Painting soft edges is one of those things that can really take your paintings to the next level. If you were to stare at your reference, all you're going to see are hard edges, but you have to learn that you need to soften some edges for parts of your painting that aren't that important. And that's a perfect thing to do on the hat here. You might think, well, you know, this hat is so small in the overall scheme of the painting, but this is the focal point. And so if you spend a little bit more time on it to make sure that you get the planes, the edges, the sides of the hat, and of course the values right, then you don't have to go back in and do any touch-ups later on. And it's always nice to have it done and be able to move on and not come back and have to adjust it. And so right now it's just a matter of I'm blending the edges a little bit where that transition goes from light into shadow, and continue to work on the edges here. And so I'll put in the hat band, just lay it in generally, and then go back in and kind of carve it away, soften the edges, make it look the way you want it to look, not too overworked, a little bit looser. And then I'll go in on the back edge of that hat brim and soften it up so that it doesn't look like it's cut out from the background. And that should about do it for the hat. I think the darkness of the underside of the rim of the hat, the brim of the hat, I put in kind of the general overall tone of his face in a shadow. A human skin can be pretty red, as I talked about a little bit before in some of my other tutorials. And so I know that this guy is going to be red, especially backlit against the sky. I want to make sure that his skin really comes across as warm. And so you put that general burnt sienna tone in and put it in thin enough that I can still see the drawing underneath, just a little tiny ghost image of it. And I use that for a guide in order to put my planes down. But really, there's not much detail in his face. You need to make sure that his eyes are in the right place and, you know, he's looking a little bit worried, and that his mustache is the right value. And you've got some shadow coming off the bottom part of his nose. So I try not to overpaint these things. I can always go back in and add some detail, but generally it's better to keep it simpler at this point. Don't overpaint things. And by overpainting them, I just mean worrying about the details too soon. You know, keep those edges softer and put in your values where they need to go. Step back often to gauge what you're doing, because people are not going to be looking at the painting right up on top of it. You need to get that general distance between you and where the viewer is generally going to be seeing the painting. And, you know, refer to your reference. Get your, like I said, get your values in early, and keep those planes, the different sides of what you're painting, in mind. And if you do that, then you're going to be just fine. And look, make a shot at it, take a shot, and if it's not right, wipe it off and start over again. Piece of cake. But one thing we don't want to do is accept something that's not as good as we can possibly paint it. And so, you know, paint with a little bit of a critical eye, or a lot of a critical eye, knowing that you can adjust things later, but don't say, well, that's good enough, because with that way lies mediocrity, and you don't want that. One of my favorite quotes is, you can be great or you can be comfortable, but you can't be both. So try and guard yourself against being too comfortable and accepting things in your work that you wouldn't accept in someone else's. Now, you may have noticed that I put down a general tone, that reddish tone, you know, the burnt sienna, for his face, and now I'm kind of slowly darkening it up so that it gets to the value that it should be.
You put something down, you try and get it as close as you can, and then you adjust as you go along. And so when I originally put that down, it was a good place to start, but I noticed that it was too light. And so I just kind of slowly added some browns and some grays to darken them up. And I will continue to do that until I feel like I got them at exactly the right place. The thing about painting someone's face in shadow is that there's not a whole lot of difference in your values, especially if you're lit the way he is, with the brim of his hat causing a lot of shadow on his face. And all my reference, I squint down at it and it will show me where the values are. And if you pay attention to that, you won't go far wrong. I touched on something a few minutes ago about stepping back from your painting because people are not going to be right on top of it like you are when you're painting it. When I paint, I stand. I don't sit because I'm constantly moving away from the painting, getting a little bit of distance and seeing how it works. Everything that you do to a painting, every stroke you put on, doesn't just affect that area, but it affects the other areas around it. It affects the whole painting. And so it's a really good habit to get into to not get comfortable and plop yourself down in a chair and not move at all. Usually by the end of the day, I'm pretty beat from doing all that walking. I've walked, but I haven't really gone anywhere. But I find that if I don't do that, then when I get to the end of the day and I do step back, what I thought was successful very oftentimes isn't. So give yourself the knowledge that you can't be comfortable doing this necessarily. You keep yourself up and constantly be walking back and forth from your easel. I probably step back about, oh, let me take a look here. Oh, it's probably 10 or maybe 15 feet, something like that. But it's really important that you give yourself that space, no matter where you're painting, because if you don't, you're going to end up getting tunnel vision. And what you think you've painted, you're not going to be happy with it when you do end up stepping back. So take your time and remember to do that. I do it pretty regularly. Do a lot of walking during the day. As I'm looking at the video here, it gives you the impression that the eye on the right-hand side is much darker than the eye on the left-hand side. I think that's a trick of the video. It's not actually like that. I think it's just catching a little bit of light so that it looks wrong. But I can tell you they're both the same value. They're both the same darkness. So I got the head to a place where I was pretty happy with it, and now I'm able to move on to the hand. This is really just a matter. There's most of it is in shadow. There's a little chunk of it on top of the thumb and on a little bit on the inside of the palm that's in sunlight. So I will be sure to keep those two values quite different. You don't need a whole lot of detail when you're painting something like this, especially when it's in the shadow like this. Just let the shape and the color do all the heavy lifting for you. You get those values right. You keep the colors pretty close to what you have in the face, and it's going to read right. Now, if you're painting the fingers, something like this, and you find that they creep a little bit on you, they get a little bit too thick, just take on your brush and paint back into them, and sculpt them a little bit using your brush. And that's the easiest way to not have to worry about whether or not the fingers or something gets too big. Remember, you've painted them a certain size and everything is adjustable. So don't be afraid to go in there and carve it out. A lot of times painting is a little like sculpture in that you put something down and you know that you're going to go in with the paint that surrounds it and carve out the shape that you want it to be. And then if you carve too much, then you add a little bit back. It's like taking and putting clay into a sculpture and taking it away. You just keep working it until you're happy with it. But one of the things that you don't want to do is say, well, that's too much trouble. I'll leave it the way it is. No one's going to notice. Trust me, people will notice. And so I've gone on to, you know, doing a little bit more work on the hat, and I'm going to be laying in his fringe coat here in a moment. But when you look at that hand, there's not a whole lot of detail in there. You don't have to paint in every distinction between every finger. That's not the way your eye sees anyways. You paint them as a bulk, and then you can go in and add a little definition if you need to. But the more that you can paint something as a shape, as like a jigsaw shape, rather than thinking of it as an object, whether it's fingers or a coat or, you know, a sleeve or folds, something like that, as long as you can think of it as just a jigsaw shape, it's going to go much easier for you, especially if you nail the values. You nail the values, painting becomes a whole lot easier. You know, a little while ago, I talked about painting planes, and I've had some people ask me what I mean by that. And so I'll go ahead and try and explain it a little bit here now. And so when I'm talking about planes, I'm definitely not talking about airplanes. Basically, planes in art are the surfaces of an object that, when drawn or painted correctly, give the object a 3D quality. So everything you paint is made up of these geometric planes, even clouds and dust. And by breaking the surfaces down into simpler planes, you can describe something's surface much more quickly and believably. And so basically what I'm talking about when I'm talking about painting planes is to simplify the surface so that you're not trying to paint every little nuance to it, but you're trying to paint it in as simple a form as you possibly can.
Thank you.
I thought what I'd like to do is go ahead and cover some questions that I get from you. The first question that I get pretty regularly is, how do I keep my colors from getting muddy? And I would have to say, you know, thinking about this, is that, you know, colors look muddy kind of because of what is next to them. And so when you put your colors down, there's a couple things I do. One thing is to make sure that I get the color that I want right off the bat. The second thing that's really important is you kind of paint with a light touch. You don't go in and slam things in. Generally, if you can put it in and leave it alone, it will sit over top of the paint that's below it. Sometimes I'll put colors down knowing that they're going to mix with the color below it and will bring it to the color that I want. But generally, I try and mix the color that I want. And it's okay if they, you know, if they mush together a little bit, but you add the paint over the top, and generally you try and do it with a lighter touch so that you don't disturb the paint that's underneath it too much. I think a lot of times you'll get into trouble if you put something down and you just keep going over and over and over it again. So try and put it down and leave it alone. And if it's not right, one of the ways that you can avoid getting muddy colors is you wipe it off and paint over the top of that. And then you're not trying to put fresh paint into paint that's not correct. And if you do that, then you're not going to have the problem with muddy colors. Okay, so I hope that helps. The second question that I get quite a bit is, what medium do I use? And believe me when I tell you, I've used just about every medium that's out there on the market. And I had for a long time a problem with controlling my paint, I guess is the best way to put it. So some of the mediums that I've used over the years is just a general painting medium of a third Damar varnish, one-third linseed oil, and one-third turpentine. That's your general run-of-the-mill medium, and that will give you open paint for a longer amount of time. The problem that I have with most mediums is the fact that they will stay open for a few days, but then they'll start getting tacky. Once they get tacky, you can't work into them. You have to wait until the painting dries enough that you can then go ahead and what they call oil out your painting, which just basically means put a thin layer of medium over the top, very thin layer, and then you can work over the top of it again, looking like it's wet into wet. When I oil out, my recipe for that is 80% stand oil and 20% gum spirits. If you're interested in how to do that, just do a search on YouTube for oiling out an oil painting, and you'll find out how to do that. It's very simple. That does work, but again, I run into the problem, especially when I'm doing these longer paintings where, you know, I'll paint, be able to paint for 3 or 4 days, and then it'll start getting tacky, and I'll have to wait another 3 or 4 or 5 days until it's dry enough that I can go ahead and oil it out again. The oil painting medium that I choose to use is just good old Liquin Original. And Liquin does a couple things for me that I really like. One is that, and I mix it into every paint mixture that I do. So every time I'm putting paint onto my canvas, it has a little bit of Liquin in it. That does a couple things for me. One is that it dries very quickly. So if I paint one day and stop at the end of the night, when I come into the studio in the morning, as long as I haven't painted too thick, that paint is already dry. And so you're probably saying to yourself, yeah, it's dry. So how do I get that wet into wet look? Well, as long as you continue to mix a little bit of Liquin into each of your mixtures, you'll be able to paint over the top of that, and it will look like you're painting wet into wet. It's one of the coolest things, and it was a real epiphany for me when I finally discovered that that worked for me. And I asked, you know, I talked to a lot of painters over the years as I was learning and asked them, you know, how do you keep working into your paint? And I never got a decent answer. until I took Scott Christensen's plein air class, and he mixes Liquin into every one of his mixtures out on location. And then I noticed when he was doing a demonstration in the studio, he had a big gob of Liquin out, and he would mix his Liquin in, and he never seemed to have to stop from day to day. He was always able to continue on. And so I started experimenting with that, and I found that that was the answer for me. Now, it won't work for everybody. There are as many ways of working if you're an artist as there are artists. So you can give it a try, see if it works for you. Some people like being able to come into the studio and have their paintings be dry, and others don't. So just give it a try, see if it works for you. Try it more than once, you know, give yourself some time to adjust. Everything that's new is going to feel a little uncomfortable, but that may be the answer that you're looking for, and I do hope that helps. The other thing you get when you paint with Liquin is your paintings remain vibrant even when dry, and so that's another big plus in my book. Yeah, you guys ask some awesome questions, some really intelligent ones, and sometimes it takes me a while to think through the answer. Because, you know, I've been doing this, and maybe it's because I've been around my paint fumes too much, but sometimes I have to think it through a little bit. But I love getting the questions that you guys leave for me. I do try and answer every one of them. Sometimes it takes me a little bit extra time, but eventually I'll get around to all of them. I think one of the best ways to become a better artist is to try and do some teaching and to figure out the answers to your questions. I know if I can't, there's a lot of really smart viewers out there. Sometimes they'll answer your questions for you way better than I can. And I love seeing that too. It's just, it's another example of how we're a great community. Anyways, getting back to the painting, here's the next couple of sessions that I'm going to be showing you that I worked on these draft horses. And let me start by showing you this. I took a moment here to show you the system that I've used to paint these horses. And what I've done is I do puddles of paint that give me all the different values and color temperatures that I'm going to need in order to paint them. The value that I have on the upper part, the top part of the screen, is the value that I'm going to start with. And that's that value right there. And I will dip into those different puddles as I go along. And if I need to lighten them or darken them or bend them a little bit warmer or cooler, I can do that. But this way I can paint quickly and not have to take all the time in order to remix those colors. I know that what I have there is going to work together because I've mixed the puddles close to each other. And I know that the lightest lights are there and the darkest darks are there. And if when I get to the shadows, I need to paint something a little darker, I can go ahead and add in, you know, a little bit of that darker value. But everything is going to be consistent across these two horses. So it's something I learned whenever I was starting to paint plein air. There are some artists out there that will teach you how to mix up these puddles. It seems like it's a pain in the butt in order to take the time to do this. But I guarantee you, if you're out in the field and you want to paint quickly, get these puddles mixed up beforehand, your light sides and your shadow sides. Man, once you get to painting whatever it is, the scene that you're painting, it's going to go so fast and so much easier that it will really be worth it in the long run. That's just something to kind of think about. I don't always mix the puddles, but on something like this that has the values that are so close together, I wanted to go ahead and do that, and I thought I'd show you. So I hope that gives you a little glimpse into what you can do differently for yourself down the road. Another thing I'd like to call your attention to what I'm doing here is the direction of the strokes that I'm putting down. I once had somebody tell me that you should paint your strokes in the direction that rain would go down of the form. And although I do that sometimes, you know, you don't want to do that for everything, but it's a good idea to think about applying your paint so that you're describing the form that you're painting. If you are very haphazard in the direction of your strokes, things aren't going to read very well. It's going to seem all jumbly. And right now, everything is not as smooth as it's going to be, but generally the direction of the strokes is there, and I can go in and soften things up. But I'm always thinking about what direction do I want to put my strokes down, and why would I put them in that direction? Basically, it's how do I want to describe the form, and how can I do it more convincingly? I'm starting now to put in the harness system on the horses, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about the importance of understanding what it is that you're painting. If you don't know, let's say, something like this, the complicated harness system for heavy pulling for horses, you need to go on the internet, look at your reference, find reference that does help you to understand it, because if you don't, I guarantee you, if you paint something and you don't take the time to know how something works, you're going to paint it incorrectly. And someone who does know it is going to either tell you in a situation that's rather embarrassing, or they're going to go and talk to your gallery owner, or even worse, other collectors and patrons, and not tell you exactly what's wrong with it. You're going to get the reputation of not knowing what the heck it is you're painting. And there's very little that's as bad as that. I've actually painted cowboys, and I've had cowboys come up to me and tell me, son, that rear cinch is way too loose. If that horse goes on to uneven ground, that saddle's going to fall off and the cowboy's going to end up on his So I've made sure from then on to always understand and make sure that I get something right before I release it out to the public. If I don't understand how, let's say, horse tack works, I stop myself and I do the research so that I do understand it and I know what I'm painting. I have ridden horses. I did that so that I would understand how to saddle a horse, you know, cinching them and making sure that the knots are tied right and that, you know, the position of the rider is correct. So if you're painting something that you don't understand, you need to take the time and inform yourself so that you do understand it and you're going to get it right. Because there's nothing worse than painting something and having someone come up to you in a show and say, oh, brother, you really need to look at this. But now I'm not one of those people who, and I've read this before, you shouldn't paint anything that you've never done yourself or, you know, you should live what it is that you paint. Look, illustrators and artists have been painting things that they haven't done themselves. I mean, look at Michelangelo. He wouldn't have been able to paint the Sistine Chapel because he's never seen angels and flying cupids and all those different things that he painted. But what he did do is he taught himself what he needed to know in order to intelligently paint the scenes. Illustrators during the Golden Age of Illustration, and even up to this day, fantasy artists, all the time they make things up. So don't buy into the idea of, well, unless you live that lifestyle every day, you can't paint it. Is it harder to paint correctly? Sure. But there are a lot of ways to learn what you need to know in order to be able to tell those stories. And as long as you do the work, you can do the paintings. Yeah, I'm a big believer in you paint what it is that excites you. And if it excites you, you're going to do the research that you need in order to be able to paint things accurately. And that's where I'm a stickler is. I really want to make sure that I know as much as I need to know in order to be able to paint something. And if I don't know it, I have experts. I have people who I can call on that will tell me when I'm wrong and they'll keep me on the right path. And nowadays, with the internet, there's no excuse not to be able to do your own research. You don't even have to go to the library. You sit down in your easy chair and you read and you find out what you need to know. Simple as that. And honestly, if you're doing a painting of a subject, you already have enough interest in it. You're probably doing this already anyways. So I'm not telling you anything new. So I'll just shut up now. Thank you. Welcome back. I've noticed that on the bottom part of these horse collars, the dye gets worn off of the leather because the horse is constantly rubbing up against it and wearing it off. So that's why you're seeing this purple color or pink color underneath, is because that black has been worn off by the horse. And it just makes for a more believable image that this isn't a brand new horse collar that's been put on them. They've worn this quite a bit. And so it's those little details, the wear and tear, so that everything doesn't look brand new. I like to make sure that things look like they've been used and it just haven't been pulled out of a store box somewhere. This is especially true when I'm painting the chaps on a cowboy or on his pants. I'd like to make sure that he's got some dust or dirt, especially towards the bottom part down towards the boots and things like that. I'd played with the idea of dirtying up the main robber who's standing on the ground, of dirtying up his shirt. And, I struggled with that. Do I want to make him dirty? And I decided against it. It was just a kind of an artistic decision. It could have gone either way. But the words of a collector kept ringing in my ear. She once told me that in life there are bow-legged women and swayback horses. But that doesn't mean people want to buy paintings of them. So I guess it just says you kind of have to decide where it is you draw the line. I wanted this guy a little cleaner, like he was a successful robber, rather than being desperate and at the end of his rope. This guy does it because he enjoys it, and he's good at it. I know what you're thinking. I can hear you out there. You're saying, yeah, but Steve, how common were these stagecoach robberies? I mean, didn't Hollywood just make these up? Well, the fact is, they didn't. There were a real rash of stagecoach robberies starting right after the Civil War in 1865. And I think the last one occurred somewhere around 1916. The fact is, there were between 300, 500, 600 of these holdups over the years. In fact, in 1914, there were 25 stagecoaches held up at one time during a Yellowstone National Park tour. At that time, in Yellowstone, they didn't have paved roads back then. They would bring the people in stagecoaches. Well, there was a line of 25 of them that were stopped by stagecoach robbers, and everybody was relieved of their cash and jewels of, I think it was about $1,000. And in fact, there were so many stagecoaches that during the robbery, one of the stagecoaches was able to turn around and go back for help without even being seen. Now, these guys were eventually caught because one of the tourists kept his head about him and he took a photo of one of the robbers, and that helped law enforcement to locate them and identify them. But yeah, no, they did happen quite a bit. Now, Wells Fargo, from what I understand, did not have passengers. They were more of a transportation kind of company. So they would move mail and money and things like that. So they were frequently a target of these stagecoach robbers. One of my favorite books on this subject is called Shotguns and Stagecoaches, The Brave Men Who Rode for Wells Fargo in the Wild West by John Bosenecker. You know, he makes a really good point in here where he talks about how Wells Fargo of their day was the equivalent to FedEx of today. You know, most of the stuff that they transported was just everyday things, merchandise. But they did have that 1% where they were transporting money. They became a company during the gold rush days and continued on after that. But they were frequently a target of a lot of these robbers. And anytime they would have a shipment that had a lot of gold in it or was very valuable, they would have what was called shotgun messengers that would ride beside the driver who was supposed to handle any kind of robberies. They were supposed to dissuade these robbers from stopping them. Didn't always work, but I do know that the stagecoaches that had these shotgun messengers were not as prone to being robbed as the ones who did. In fact, one of the most famous stagecoach robbers was named Black Bart, And only once did he ever hold up a stagecoach that had a shotgun messenger, and he was shot. But he was only grazed. He was fine. But I think he learned his lesson there. But one of the things that made Black Bart so different from all the other ones and so hard to catch was that he would hold up his stagecoaches. They wouldn't have shotgun messengers. He wouldn't get away with a lot of loot, but he would get away with some. And he never rode a horse. And so it was very hard to track him. He would pull over these stagecoaches up in this rough country, and he'd get away on foot. So they had a very hard time finding him. He always had a bag over his face so that no one could identify him. For a long time, a lot of people thought it was the unknown comic. Sorry, I couldn't resist. In fact, the very first time he held up a stagecoach, he told the driver to throw down the money. And just as an aside, he said over his shoulder into the bushes, "Guys, if he says anything or if he does anything, go ahead and shoot him." And so the stagecoach driver looked over into the bushes and saw all these rifles sticking out and decided against trying anything, threw down the money and went on. And then a couple hours later, another stage came by and he did exactly the same thing. Well, it turns out that there were no other rifles in the bushes. He simply had taken a bunch of straight sticks and stuck them out of the bush. So he bluffed his way into being successful that time. But he was always very friendly, very well-spoken. Black Bart was known as the poet highwayman because a couple of times he left a couple poems taunting law enforcement to try and catch him. But they eventually did. They figured out who he was because of a laundry mark on one of his handkerchiefs when they found his holdout. And he wasn't there, but his laundry was there. And so they, using good old-fashioned police tactics and legwork, they found the launderer who did his laundry. And when he was arrested, everybody was shocked because they thought he was a businessman. Eventually, he did confess to his crimes. He took them to where he had stashed the money. And I think he got only 6 years because they only convicted him of one of these robberies. But he actually did many dozens of robberies. Anyways, he got 6 years. They released him early because of good behavior. And the stagecoach robberies promptly started up again. And so they put out his photo and tried to catch him. But no one ever saw him again. Probably one of the most well-known stage robbers in American West history. And so that was Black Bart's story. You know, I don't think I ever told you his real name. His real name was Charles Bowles, and I'll flash his picture up here so that you can see what he looked like. He's quite the dude. Thank you. as we're coming down towards the end of finishing the painting here, all I have left are his boots. And so I'm putting them in with the shadow side and the side that's in the sunlight, painting them as simply as I can, saving any details for later on. But right now, just trying to get the values right. I will adjust the color temperatures as I go along. But for right now, it's just important that I get the initial values correct so that they read like they should, and then soften the edges between the light side and the shadow side. And that's pretty much the recipe for any of the things that I paint. The objects are all kind of painted in a similar manner, unless it's something like clouds, and those have soft edges all the way through. But generally, anything that is material that I paint, I'll do it this way. You paint the shadow side and you paint the light side. And then once you get those two values established, then you work on the edges, the color temperature, and the blending between the light and the shadow side. This is the end of the actual painting portion that I'll be showing you, but looking at the money bags that are at his feet there, they're still not finished. So I did have some more paint to go on here and some more detail. But as far as what I'll be showing you step by step, this will be the end of it. But after this, I'm going to show you the time lapse of the painting as it progressed day by day. And I think that will show you really clearly how I went about putting this painting together, what I decided to do first, and what I decided to kind of hold off until the end. Things like adding dust and stuff like that. But painting these boots was fun, first of all, because it was one of the last things I had to do on the figures, and second of all, because there's so much reflected light that goes on in here in the shadow side of his boots. And so I like to see things come to life by adding that reflected light. It really adds life to the painting and makes it a whole lot more believable. And so there I put in a little bit of that purple reflected light, and we'll do it also on that back boot there that I'm working on now. As always, I want to thank you all for tuning in. I sure do appreciate it. I hope that this helped a little bit. If you have any questions, if I've left things out that are glaring omissions, just let me know. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have. I do thank you for subscribing. If you haven't subscribed, but this is something that you like, go ahead and subscribe. Hit the notification bell. You know the drill. If you like the video, hit the like button. It really helps me out. I usually try and post a new video every week, although I was a little tardy on this one. I will try and get back to being on a more regular schedule. I have my next video all recorded and ready to go. Just a little more editing. Oh, and if there's something that you're interested in having me demonstrate or talk to you about or do a video on, let me know. I'm here to help you get better at your art. Well, that brings this one to an end. I'm going to clean my brushes and turn off the studio lights. I thank you for showing up, and as always, I'll see you down the road.